Welcome to PayPod, the show that features thought-provoking interviews with leaders and entrepreneurs in the payments and financial technology industries. From credit card processing to Bitcoin, we cover it all. So if you want to know what's happening right now in the payments industry, stay tuned. Now, here's your host, Scott Hawksworth.
Hey, how's it going, PayPod listeners? Scott here again with you, and get ready for another fantastic episode. I'll start today's episode with a simple question for you. Do you like the idea of recurring revenue? Does a business that accepts payments from their customers on, for example, a monthly basis via a subscription sound appealing? If the answer is yes, then you are not alone. Many entrepreneurs and executives have realized the power of subscription-based technologies. That said, like with any model, there are payments and technological considerations to make it all work and work smoothly. On this episode, we're going to be diving into that side of things with the help of our guest, Nick Frederick, who is the president of Rebar Technology Solutions, LLC. Rebar was created to help companies needing support with subscription technology and operations. Nick's expertise brings his clients improved revenue and reduced expenses while implementing systems that scale faster and with greater stability. Rebar Technology has a leg up in the financial technology realm. So with all that said, let's just jump right in. I can't think of a better guest to have to talk about subscriptions. Nick, welcome to the show.
Awesome. Thanks for having me, Scott.
Thank you for being here. To start us off, can you tell us just a little bit more about your career and how you ended up as the president of Rebar?
Yeah, sure. Happy to do that. So I tell people I've actually had two careers in my life, and one somewhat led into the other one. I'm based here in Nashville, Tennessee, have lived here most of my life. And actually, my first career was in the music industry. I was on the production side of things, work with artists from a touring perspective, and spent a lot of my life on the road doing various roles, various jobs. But the last one I had in that industry was a tour manager. And a good bit of that responsibility that I had was really on the accounting side, you know, making sure that we were getting paid for each show and then reporting back to the business managers and kind of keeping up with everything from my financial perspective, merchandise, all that kind of good stuff. Mm-hmm. When I got a little bit later on in life, knew that I didn't want to spend life on the road, so made a transition over to more of a permanent in-town role. And that's when I started at a company called Affinion Group on the accounting side. Really, Affinion Group is a marketer of subscription and insurance products, primarily through financial institutions. And, you know, as a part of that role, which started in accounting, I was doing reconciliations. So all of the various partners that we had, reconciling the cash payments we would receive to payouts to them, commissions, that sort of thing. So started out there. And then that transitioned into a role within that organization that we refer to as billing operations. So like I said, Affinion Group operated a lot of different products, membership clubs, a product called Privacy Guard, which is credit monitoring service, a lot of insurance products like accidental death and dismemberment. And then we actually operated some loyalty programs as well. So it was a conglomeration of a lot of different companies. It was a pretty high volume environment. We processed a little over 1 billion transactions a year with over 24 different endpoints, whether that was an acquirer or partner that we processed payments through. And so that experience was invaluable because it just exposed me to a lot of different payment methods, partners, ways of processing payments and billing transactions that, you know, still involved with to this day. So I was at Affinity Group for 11 years, held roles, like I said, in billing ops, there, fulfillment, IT, just got to see the business from a lot of different angles. But that was where I really got into subscription and learned the ins and outs and how it worked. From there, I moved into a company called W Capra Consulting, which is actually a sister company to Rebar Technology. And in that role there, I did the same sort of thing that I was doing at Affinion, but really did it for other merchants. So coming in from a consulting perspective, helping them optimize payments. When it comes to recurring billing, you're always looking to optimize and collect every payment transaction possible. So I was able to extend the expertise and experience that I accumulated at Affinion and really help other merchants do the same thing. As part of that process or those engagements that we had on the consulting side, work with various partners and vendors out there in the space that provided payment and subscription related technology services, and really saw a gap. There's a proliferation of SaaS-related companies out there today that are providing services to this industry. But in the way that SaaS companies typically deliver their services, it's a bit of a walled garden, right? There's configuration that you can do to sort of customize it, but you're kind of living in their world. And for a lot of businesses, especially small ones, that makes a lot of sense. But we work primarily with, you know, large organizations, Fortune 1000 type companies. And inevitably, in every deployment we ever did, there were gaps in user stories or just general business requirements that couldn't be met by that particular vendor platform. And so when it came to that gap, somebody had to solve for it. So either that was the business acquiescing to a new way of doing things, or them developing an internal solution to work around it, or trying to find some other third party that could do it. So what you inevitably ended up with was a cobbled together system of third-party applications, SaaS platforms, and internal systems that formed your subscription platform. So in seeing that happen time and time again, we said, I think there's a different way to do this. And that's kind of how Rebar was born. We take what I just like to refer to as a modular approach to subscription systems, in that we built a lot of the common modules that you would deal with from a subscription lifecycle perspective, whether that's a product catalog, you know, an account, a subscription, payment transactions, invoices, all those kinds of things that are pretty common, but built them in a microservices way that we can plug and play different components together, and sometimes even plug in third-party components if that's what a particular merchant needs. So that was our goal when we started Rebar, was to take that different approach. So we launched the company just over 2 years ago. We recently got our platform launched and, you know, our first merchant's up and running on it. So we're really, really excited about it. But as you can see, it's been quite an evolution just to get to this point.
Absolutely. And I love that word evolution. I think even just in the context of your career, so many folks' careers, whether it's in payments, fintech, or otherwise, there's an evolution. You build that experience and you build on top of it, and it leads you to where you are. Today, you know, you were sharing us a little bit about what led to Rebar and that story. And we're talking about subscription-based businesses and services today, and in particularly the financial and technological sides that really power them, that make them work. So before diving in deeper here, can you, I guess, set the stage? What is so powerful about subscription model businesses? Or put another way, why should a business consider a subscription model? What kinds of businesses really benefit most from one?
Yeah, interesting question. One of the things that's most interesting about it is I probably would have answered it differently 5 years ago than I would today. But I think there's two primary drivers, internal and external, to why you want to look at a subscription model. From an internal perspective, the CFOs love subscription models because they're predictable recurring revenue.
Yep.
They like the predictability of knowing roughly how much revenue is going to come in each month, right? How many members you have, how many you've been adding over time, your attrition rates for members that drop off. But it just becomes a very predictable revenue model. Managing cash and everything that goes along with that just become, you know, repetitive and easier to forecast. From an external perspective, as it relates to your customers, everyone's looking for, how do I continuously engage with my customer? Keep them engaged in my product or service. And subscription, of course, is a great way to do that. Because when they enroll in your product, it's a contract or at least a commitment from a customer perspective to engage with you over time. Usually, most subscriptions are on an ongoing repetitive basis. Some are more fixed term length. But regardless, in either case, you know, that's an ongoing relationship with a customer. So that's what everybody's looking for today. You know, when you're talking about retail, you got to keep selling widgets every month, right? Which can be hard to forecast, and inventory and everything that goes along with that. But when you're talking about subscription, things become a lot more predictable, which is certainly nice. There's a lot of businesses today that are looking into this model that, like I said, even 5 years ago, you wouldn't have ever thought of. I like to use the Volvo model. They got into the subscription car business. You can download an app or go to their website today and, you know, with a matter of clicks, be well on your way to subscribing to a car. Which is a pretty novel concept. No one ever even thought of not that long ago. And Dyson, you know, the vacuum cleaner company, did a subscription vacuum cleaner model in Japan. There's just a lot of models that you would just historically never thought of as being conducive to subscription that are clearly showing that if you think outside the box, there's creative ways to make subscription work for your business.
Absolutely. You know, there are challenges when you are implementing any kind of subscription model. You were touching on a little of this kind of in your backstory on Rebar. What are some of the biggest challenges that businesses either intending to or currently implementing a subscription-based model are facing today from the technological side?
Yeah, this goes back to that word evolution right here. When you're starting a subscription business from the ground up, let's just say a brand new product or service, your needs today and your scalability today are certainly, hopefully, different than what they're going to be 1, 2, 5 years down the road. So when you're looking at all of these platforms and partners that you're bringing in to help you grow your business, are they going to be able to support you as you grow the thing? Your requirements today might not be your requirements tomorrow. So what's their flexibility? How much are they getting to know and understand your business so that as you evolve, they're able to evolve along with you? And like I was talking about earlier, we had seen dealing with larger subscription type merchants that they have unique use cases. No two are exactly alike. Mm-hmm. They have unique needs, and sometimes their industry is heavily regulated when you talk about something like insurance and things like that. You know, their partners, their vendors, their everybody that comes together to make their business work aren't always able to evolve along with them. So I think that's kind of one of the challenges. You're wanting to get your business up and running as quickly and efficiently as possible when you're at ground level. And of course, you need to focus on that. But you need to think a little bit into the future about, okay, I grow this. I go from 1,000 members up to 10,000, up to 100,000, and hopefully millions. But when I get there, are the platforms, processes, people that I have in place going to be able to scale along with that?
Absolutely. And Rebar can help with this. Again, this is something you were touching on a little bit, but if you could dive in a little deeper, sort of, could you give us maybe some examples of what Rebar specifically might do to help subscription businesses navigate these challenges and really find that success and maybe not have quite so many bumps in the road, so to speak?
Yeah, absolutely. I think one of the things that I'm most proud of that we do, it's no doubt because we have come out of a consulting company, is that we take a consultative approach to engagements with our clients. We're not the sort of company that you can go to our website, type in your credit card number, and have a subscription billing system in an hour, right? That's not us.
Right.
We sit down, we want to know and understand your business, where you are today, where you see yourself going in the future, really take a collaborative approach to developing a roadmap so that you're able to grow and scale your business effectively and aren't having to rip things out down the road in a very painful and expensive process, but rather have thought things through and are able to scale as you grow. And kind of what goes along with that is looking at your entire ecosystem. Who are the partners that you work with today, whether that's from a fulfillment perspective, or let's just say you sell all over the country and tax applies, who are your tax vendors or that you might work with? We have solutions to a lot of those things already kind of built into our systems, whether that's native or other key partners that we've integrated with. But we're also able to be flexible and integrate with whatever partner you're comfortable with today. So if you have using the tax example, say you have a solution provider that you use today that does your tax filing all in various jurisdictions around the country, you want to continue using them, we're able to integrate them. We're not that company that says, that's your problem to solve. We're here to just walk side by side with you and help solve for things collaboratively.
I love that. And I think especially, and this is coming from the payments perspective, being able to integrate with folks' existing systems, with, you know, whatever platform they might be using, however you can do it, is always a win. I think anytime you can't do that and you're like, well, this is the only thing we can do, we can only work with this, that can limit your customer base and the opportunities there and kind of shut conversations down before they even get started in some cases.
It does. You're absolutely right.
So keeping on the payments track, here at SOAR Payments, we help businesses of all kinds get set up for merchant accounts, and we particularly have some expertise in high-risk spaces. And it may surprise some people to learn that subscription-based businesses, particularly those, for example, that are offering free trials, can sometimes have processing challenges. Chargebacks can be higher with free trials, or just recurring billing if someone forgets they were subscribed and then just issues a chargeback because, I don't know what that is. I'm curious, Nick, what are some of the financial or payments challenges you're seeing businesses with subscription models face today? Again, whether it's with payment processing or liquidity or something else entirely.
Yeah, absolutely. You hit on one of the main ones already there, Scott, which is around chargebacks, right? When it comes to subscriptions, particularly certain models or products in the way that they market them, which isn't always online, there can be a lot of different channels for marketing subscription services, customers don't always realize what they're signing up for, or sometimes just legitimately forget it, right? Especially if you're talking about a more lengthy trial, you know, 30 days or more, customer can forget that they signed up for something, that it was a free trial that had a, you know, automatic renewal at the end of that free term that they just forgot about, right? Or we've also seen with some of our clients that the person who entered the card for the subscription service wasn't necessarily the card holder or the one that pays the bill. Mm-hmm. They might be going out their billing statement and looking through the transactions and can't make out in that 40 character billing descriptor who this is that charged their card. And if it's not clear on how to reach back out to a merchant, they might just call their financial institution and start a dispute there. And if a merchant doesn't respond to it in a timely manner, you know, those sorts of things turn into chargebacks. We're seeing that a lot today. The term friendly fraud has certainly popped up in our industry, which is, you know, situations just like I described where consumers sign up for things and forget about them. Or in some cases, it's subscribers' remorse. You know, they intended to cancel and maybe didn't on a timely basis or when they were supposed to, and, you know, now kind of want their money back. So our industry, and these are kind of gets into a lot of the regulatory points, particularly when you're dealing with credit cards and processing through networks like Visa, MasterCard, you know, there's operating rules. Chargebacks can only get up to a certain threshold or level of chargeback to sales within a given period before you start to get on the network's radar. And, you know, they start questioning what's happening over there and why do you have excessive chargebacks within your organization? And then you go into a period where you have to start to work these things out. So it's just one of those things that, you know, you certainly have to be aware of. Scott, I'm sure you know this very well, dealing with higher risk merchants, that you got to monitor these things. I mean, your processing privileges can be revoked if you're not too careful with it.
Absolutely. I ran a subscription-based business for a time myself, even before I was with SOAR Payments. And unfortunately, sometimes these mistakes happen, right? People can get double billed, or, you know, there's a cancellation and something doesn't go through. Or as you mentioned, they forget something was set to renew, or they didn't get that email reminder about the free trial ending. These are the kinds of issues that can lead to these problems with payments. And then also even larger problems with, you know, bad reviews, et cetera, in which we know online reputation is crucial. So from a pure customer service standpoint, what advice might you have for those running these types of companies when subscription, I guess, billing goes wrong? What's the key to avoiding that chargeback or that negative review or that cancellation?
Yeah, those are really good questions. I think one thing that's really important is you need to have the systems and kind of alerts in place to let you know that these things are trending in the wrong direction. Don't wait until you get that notice from Visa through your acquirer sent to you that says, hey, your chargeback level is at 3% this month. You've exceeded and you're now on the radar, right? It's better to know these things are coming and get in front of them sooner rather than later. To give you kind of one example, I was working with a merchant who called us in because they felt like their authorization rates were too low. That when they were trying to process recurring payments, even some of their first time payments, they were getting what seemed to be automatic rejections from certain card issuers. And so it took us coming in, and we really, instead of, you know, they wanted us to focus on one very specific problem, but we started peeling back the layers of that onion, which meant getting into a lot of different departments within the organization to look at this subscription process from beginning to end, from solicitation to enrollment, fulfillment, and billing. And what we saw was other processes that caused chargebacks to happen actually resulted in negative reputation within the system. And in the, we now live in this world of AI and machine learning, and there were algorithms that issuers that said, wait a minute, we're seeing excessive chargebacks coming from this particular merchant or billing descriptor, what have you. And those systems started automatically flagging their payment transactions on the front end and declining authorization. So their reputation got damaged within the system as a result of chargeback. So they really didn't have a payment authorization problem. They had a chargeback problem. The payment authorization was a symptom of it. So you really have to look at things holistically. And This was a subscription-based business who'd been doing this sort of thing for a while, and they didn't know that, right? So I think one of the things that's helpful is to work with partners, whether it's consulting companies or just certain technology providers that are experts in the space who can help you get in front of these things. Because like I said, getting in front of it before it happens and trying to reverse a trend is better than getting into a fine or alert situation. Because when it comes to things like your chargeback levels, that the remediation steps you might take today don't take effect tomorrow. These things take months to play out in the system. So once you've started trending in the wrong direction, it's a bit like a cruise ship to get it, you know, righted right in the right direction. That doesn't just happen overnight.
That's making me think of just payments in general and anything around, you know, financial technology. It's so much better to start from the best place and get ahead of something rather than trying to react to something that has been going wrong for a while. You know, again, I had mentioned where we work in the high risk space with a lot of different merchants there. The amount of calls I have where I wish that I had talked to that merchant like a year ago. It's like, I wish you'd started with us because now you don't have processing and all of this. And I think that's like what you're talking about with the things that Rebar is doing, in the sense that the earlier that folks can kind of get ahead of some of these challenges, the more easily then you guys and they can see the benefits from that and really avoid the absolute worst situation.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, there's not just ourselves, but there's other great partners that we have out there who have payment analytics platforms that can really dive into your payments, summarize it in a dashboard format, but then give you drill through capability to see where things could be going wrong, whether that's a pay type or a particular issuer or a payment processor where you're seeing particular issues. You know, there's a lot of chargeback remediation services that are out there. There's chargeback insurance, as I like to call it, services that are out there. So there's a lot of great providers in our ecosystem that can help you out. But I think the first thing you have to do is just have the right alerting in place to let you know where things aren't at that right level. You know, benchmark yourself against others, against what the industry expects, to know kind of where you're at and get in front of it sooner rather than later.
Absolutely. I think one thing that is also important to discuss, you know, we were talking about why subscription-based models are so exciting, why CFOs like them, all of this. There's also just such a potential for growth. I mean, if you're billing on a monthly basis and all your customers are paying you, all you got to do is just add new customers and that's gravy, baby, right?
Absolutely.
We've seen really an explosion of growth in the e-commerce world and in the online world, accelerated in the wake of COVID-19. And this growth is exciting. And I'm sure there's lots of subscription-based businesses out there that are seeing some of this growth. But it can also bring what I would call growing pains. Scaling isn't easy, whether it's a subscription-based business or not. What growing pains do you see e-commerce businesses facing? And how can these growing pains be navigated and maybe aided by technology and services? Are there any specific solutions that make this scaling more smooth?
Yeah, it's a good question. Quick factoid on that is I saw an article on payments.com that since the start of COVID back in March, February, March, 96 million new subscriptions have been added.
Wow.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. You know, people are spending more time at home, so it's no surprise that they're subscribing to more streaming services. They're, you know, subscribing to meal delivery kit services and things like that. So it's not really that much of a surprise, but it's still just a massive number. And when you start talking about scaling, there's obviously the, can my technology platform support that kind of scaling? Can I go from billing 1,000 customers a month to 100,000 and beyond? And can my system support that? That's certainly a question that you have to ask yourself, whether it's your own internal systems or third-party service providers. But as businesses grow, they inevitably get more complicated. Growth can come in a lot of different ways. So if you think about, I market online today, right? I maybe do direct mail emails or, you know, just generic advertising, but I drive customers to my website and I enroll them there. But as you grow, you may be looking at other channels. You may look at physical direct mail, which is still a thing, and it still works very well. We have clients that do it, and it's still a very effective channel. You know, telejoins, whether that those are inbound or outbound over the phone type joins, a lot of different channels that you might say, oh, I want to grow my business that way. Well, those things don't necessarily work exactly the same. How you enroll customers isn't the same. How you capture their payment methods is likely different in those channels. So what you have to ask yourself is, do I have the right expertise within my organization to solve for those, to effectively bring those into my organizations and not cause problems in the process? And then how do we grow the size of our teams, right? I might have one person in accounts receivable today that's reconciling the cash that's coming in. But as I grow to a multi-million dollar business, how do I add to that? So being prepared for growth. I think, you know, the adage that a lot of small businesses die because they grow too fast can certainly be true for subscription as well, right? If you don't have the right people and processes in place as you grow, this goes back to that reputational thing. If you can't service your customers, deliver your product, whether that's a physical or digital good in an effective way, you're going to start damaging your reputation, which can ultimately harm your business.
Absolutely. I think those are all excellent points. It's one of those things where you have to really navigate this growth. And like we were talking about earlier, maybe be prepared for it. And if you can put any systems in place that can scale more easily, that's a win, especially if you are in a business and you're seeing growth already. You never know when you might hit that point that growth just explodes. And if you're already kind of have that framework that can handle it, that's going to be a win.
Absolutely.
Near the end of the show, I always like to turn our attention to the future. So with that in mind, Nick, if you could peer into the crystal ball, what do you see in the future for Rebar? Are there any specific products or services on the horizon that you can share, of course, that our listeners might find to be interesting?
Yeah, I think it's really continued growth of the core of what we do well, which is integrating a lot of different things together. There's a lot of players out there in our industry today. There's a lot of new payment methods that are evolving. Bitcoin is still out there. We'll see where that goes, you know, those sorts of things. And international growth as well. You know, subscription probably had its start here in the US is where it grew, but most businesses are looking to grow internationally depending on the particular type of product that they offer. But, you know, as we add additional acquirers and additional service providers into our platform, you know, it'll continue to be more powerful. So that's what we're focused on right now. And I think that's exciting because it just brings more to the table for our current and future clients.
Absolutely. It's going to be exciting to see where you guys go with all of it. All right, Nick, we have a segment that we like to end with on each and every show. It's 5 questions. It's rapid fire. Are you ready?
I am ready.
Make a prediction about the future of subscription-based businesses and related technologies that you expect will happen short-term in the next 12 to 24 months.
I would have to go with bundling. So think of, it's out there now, the Hulu and Disney and ESPN Plus bundling model, whether that's in the digital space or even in physical goods as well. But putting different things together, there's so many subscription services out there right now that you can buy one off. But I think bundling of those together to make a more compelling offer to consumers is we're going to see a lot of proliferation of that in the next couple of years.
I'm glad you mentioned like Hulu and Disney Plus, because I've been wondering, just as a consumer myself, you know, what's the inflection point when there's just too many of these different services and people just, they aren't signing up for new ones and there's a plateau. So I think bundling might be a solution there.
Yep.
What's one cool piece of payment or financial related technology that you've come across recently, unrelated directly to Rebar, that impressed you?
I think one thing that is a little bit untapped, there's a service out there called Plaid. If you're not familiar with it, they are an API-based service that allows you to allows your customers to connect through their bank account and bring that activity into your app, should the customer allow for it. In the past, you as a service provider, an app maker, would have had to do direct integrations with all of those individual banks to get access to that activity. Mm-hmm. But Plaid gives you the ability to hit a whole bunch at once. And I know that's somewhat related to your bank, but I just think it's a neat service that's kind of wrapping all of that together. We've said for a long time in fintech that there's this core banking system that has been around for decades here in the US. And all of the innovators are the ones that sit around it and do all of these add-on products on top of it, you know, whether that's a PayPal or a Venmo or, you know, all of these different things. But I think Plaid could be a very interesting way to unlock that in a very efficient method for those that want to innovate financial products over top of bank accounts.
Absolutely. In the next 5 years, most people in the US will make a purchase with either Bitcoin, cash, Apple Pay, some other thing? Which one and why?
It's a tough question. I think if we're looking 5 years from now, the most common way to make a purchase will continue to be with credit card. And I say that because credit cards aren't fundamentally broken, haven't been for a while. You know, Apple Pay is just a different way to pay with a credit card. And its market share is growing, and I could be wrong about that. Apple Pay could be the one to take over in 5 years as more people become comfortable with paying via their phone. But I think 5 years from now, I think, you know, just swiping, dipping, or entering your card online will still be the primary method. It's just a very long road for Bitcoin and other alternative payments to get to this sort of market penetration that credit cards have.
Absolutely. And one thing I'd add to that, just in my personal view, is the reward side of things.
Yeah,
consumers are so used to getting their cash back, getting their miles, whatever it is. And that's so baked into the credit card system, really. What's one piece of advice you would have for someone considering the technology or maybe financial technology, fintech industry as a career?
Yeah, I would say in the early going, be open to working in different areas of finance or technology or fintech. But once you figure out what you're passionate about, specialize, whether that's payments, whether that's banking, whether that's web-related technologies, whatever it is, pick a specialty and become an expert in that, because that's kind of set yourself up for becoming the go-to person, you know, for those sorts of expertise, and can really set you up for a career where people seek you out because of that expertise that you've gained in one particular area.
Last question. What is the best business advice you've ever received, and from whom?
To this day, I still hold on to a phrase from one of my former COOs that I worked with a while back, and that is, don't let great be the enemy of the good. And that's not a cop-out for doing things properly, but it is just accepting that in today's fast-paced business world, we've all got more to do than we have time to do it. And sometimes doing 10 things at 80% is better than doing two things at 100%. So I've found in certain situations that you sometimes just need to accept that, okay, we've done this to an acceptable level and we kind of need to move on, you know, to the next thing. So that's one phrase that I'd like to hold on to.
I think that's good advice. I'm actually thinking of something that I've heard writers talk about before, is about rewrites and trying to get something perfect. And they've said basically the comment that if I got everything I wrote perfect and didn't have any more rewrites left, I'd never release anything.
I've certainly felt that way. You know, another way to say it is kind of the law of diminishing returns here. But yeah, sometimes you just got to accept this is good enough and move on.
Absolutely. Nick, thank you so much for joining us on the show today, really sharing Rebar's story and helping us explore these subscription model businesses and the payments and technological side of it. It's crucial stuff. And I think that there's so much opportunity out there. So thank you for joining us.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Scott, and giving us the opportunity to share.
Absolutely. And before I let you go, if folks are listening, maybe they are trying to get their subscription started up, or maybe they have some challenges and they need some help, where can they go? How can they find out more, connect with you guys?
Sure, definitely. They can go to our website, rebartechnology.com, but we really love to talk with people. Like I said, we take that consultative approach. We love to have conversations, learn more about you. So you can always email us, info@rebartechnology.com, or fill out the form on our website, but we just love to have a conversation.
Awesome. Thanks again, Nick.
Thanks, Scott.
Well, that's it for our show today. Thank you so much for listening. And if you like what we do here, don't forget to rate and review us on iTunes or whatever your preferred podcast listening platform is. We'll be back with another episode very soon.
Thank you for listening to another episode of PayPod, brought to you by Soar Payments. Soar Payments is a leading merchant services provider for e-commerce, high-risk, and hard-to-place businesses. If you'd like to get the latest PayPod episode sent to you automatically, subscribe to the show via iTunes or Stitcher, or visit soarpay.com/podcast.